around his chest. The hairs on his head were white, like white wool, and like snow. His eyes were flame like fire, and his feet were like burnished bronze, refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and from his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying, "Fear not, I am the first and the last, and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I have the keys of the kingdom and death, and the death of Hades. Write, therefore, the things that you have seen, those that are and those that will take place after this. As for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, the seven golden lampstands and the seven stars, the angels of the seven churches and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." In Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, it tells us extremely clearly that the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, and the things that might soon take place. One of the things of which has happened to the book of Revelation, as we all know immediately, everybody thinks 666, Antichrist, and Hoor of Babylon, and all of the end times, and the tribulations, and all of these kinds of things. And to a certain degree, I guess that's true. My problem with it is that we forget who the book is about. We forget the fact that this is the revelation of Jesus Christ. It is not the revelations of end times.
Right.
It is about our Lord and Savior. And if you want the good news, it is about the fact that we are overcomers and we win. That, thank you very much, brother. We like to get caught up in all of the rest of it, but the truth of the matter is that every book in the Bible, and I don't care from Genesis right through to Maps, it is to reveal God and who God is, and it's to reveal Jesus Christ as the Son of God. First and foremost, when we pick up our scriptures, that's what we're supposed to look for. The rest of it, if you want, falls into place of because of who Jesus Christ is, and thus also with Revelations. John's aim is not at our knowing how or when these things will take place. His aim is that they will happen, and that through Jesus Christ we will be overcomers. That's what the aim of Revelations is, first and foremost. John's aim is for our recognizing that Jesus Christ shall reign on the throne, and the fact that Jesus is on the throne is what Revelations would have us to know. Who is our Lord? Jesus Christ. Where is he? He's seated at the right hand of the Father. You know him as Savior, but yet we must also know him as Lord and King, and that's one of the things of which the book of Revelations brings out very plainly, is the fact that Jesus is Lord. We must know his judgments in our life as well as his love. The purpose of the book is also to cause us to know more of Jesus and to be watchful and to be prepared for the day of his return. It helps us in those kinds of things. We won't cover the whole book, but over the next 4 or 5 weeks, we are going to look at these same verses from 9 to 20 and bring out the fullness of Jesus Christ within the church and within the seven churches and the judgments of those seven churches. John has called the disciples who has leaned upon the bosom of Christ in John chapter 13, verse 25, and John chapter 21, verse 20, where he spoke of the John, the Revelator, leaning upon the breast of Christ during the Passover meal. Also, he speaks of himself as the one whom Jesus loved. And I heard it preached many times that Jesus loved John better than all the rest, and you can't show me that in Scripture. What it says is that John had an understanding that Jesus Christ really loved him. And we should all have that same understanding. He was the one whom Jesus love, and so are each and every one of us, if we can just grasp it in the same way of which John did, and the fullness of John and all of that. Under what circumstances John been here? Well, John was out preaching the gospel, and the higher ups, the power in Rome, decided that maybe what he needed was a little holiday, so they sent him to the Isle of Patmos, which is a bare, rocky place of hard times. I don't suspect it was so much hard labor, but I want you to understand he was banished to this island and separated from the church and all of those of whom he loved. And in that, the punishment must indeed have been very great. John's love of the church is absolutely outstanding within all of the community. He cares for the church. He loves the church. He understands it's the body of Christ, and his separation from that would be the same way for any of us to be banished from our own physical families and saying, that's it, you can't have any more contact with them. This is the way that he would feel, and it would tear him apart. Although John is very much a sensitive man, I want you to see his heart. Verse 9. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom of patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the Isle of Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Our modern day concepts or idea is that we have to tell people how much better we are, or those kinds of things. I guess, as Paul expounded this morning during the communion, that it is a sense of boasting of how good I am is also a sense of judgment against others, okay? And so we get a lot of people, even within the church, who have this idea that they have a direct line to Christ that nobody else has, or whatever the case may be, and I have this anointing and you don't have it, and yada, yada, yada. But look at the heart of Paul, of John, I mean, where he is humble and sensitive. He calls them brothers in the kingdom of God. Here's a man of whom claims that Jesus loved them, and he did. He walked with Jesus right from the very beginning. He spent 3 years with Jesus. He was learned everything. He was one of the most faithful of them all. And yet, at the same time, he looked at all of those within the church and said, these are my brothers in Christ. He never judged them, as Paul said this morning, for their sins. He never judged them for where they were. What he did is he accepted them as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ because he knew that they had accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior and allowed the Holy Spirit to work in each and every one of their lives. Though his body is in the Isle of Patmos, that he's been sent away, his spirit is still with his brothers, and they are suffering together in patience, waiting for the kingdom. I, your brother, wait with you patiently, he says, for this kingdom that is which is coming. He has a feeling for the body of Christ and a love for the body of Christ, of which is the Church of Jesus Christ. He understands that God is dealing with each and every one of them, and that his job is first and foremost to show them the love of Jesus Christ and allow the Holy Spirit to work in it. John also knows that the revelation, or the relationship between tribulation and the kingdom and patience is inseparable. Let me say that one more time. He understands the relationship between tribulation and the kingdom and patience are inseparable. If you'll flip back with me, please, to Acts chapter 14, verse 22. Acts 14, verse 22, this is Paul. He says, strengthening the souls of disciples, encouraging them to continue in faith, and saying that through many tribulations we may enter the kingdom of God. I encourage you in the faith, and through our tribulations we are going to enter into the kingdom of God. Paul also wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. For this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an equal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Those things in which we suffer bring us glory in the end and bring God glory in the end. And I'm not a big fan of suffering. I don't know where you guys are at, but I'm not a big fan of it. But I will tell you this. I remember those times far better than the good times. You know what? Think about when you were a teenager and you get together with all your old buddies from school. And the stories that come up at the school reunion are about what? Do you remember that bright sunshiny day of when we went out to the lake and we went swimming? No. Do you remember that time we went out to the lake and it rained like crazy and we got stuck and we had to go get old Joe Farmer to come pull us up? Those are the stories we remember. When things happened which caused us a certain amount of hardship or pain or whatever the case may be. And so thus it is also in our Christian walk. How many of us really, truly, I don't want you to put up your hands, remember all the good times with Jesus versus the times of when it was tough and Jesus came? Really? Okay? And in fact, Paul understands this, and when he wrote about the idea of the kingdom being slow and coming, or at least it seems extremely slow to us, but then he said that out of true patience, we will grow, and out of suffering, we will grow. One of the things is that without patience, okay, slumbering can hardly be avoided. If we're not patient for God, if we get in a hurry, then one of the things which happens is either we're going to start sliding back and go into a slumber and say, well, yeah, and Paul wrote about this also because he said, you know what, you people have to understand that you have to keep a watchful eye for Jesus and his return. For otherwise, you'll just slide back. And so our patience is enabled by the Holy Spirit that we can do this. The other thing is that without patience, the world's attractions become very bright and shiny. When we're no longer looking for Jesus, then what are we looking for? We're looking at the world, and the things of the world will draw us away from him. So John and us wait patiently. John believes that he has a part with his brothers in all of this, and this, as Paul said, we're all in the same boat. I'll tell you what, we're all in the same boat of waiting patiently for Jesus Christ. Amen. And he's going to come. And we have to believe that. It's the preparation for that journey, okay? And maybe some of us get drawn apart, as he said, concerning the idea of all of them taking the class in order to be exchange students. But when that 16 hours of flight, suddenly they were all together in one kinship. And I believe that though we see our churches separated, and though we may see problems in the churches and those kinds of things, when Jesus Christ is revealed, it will all be done. And the friendship and the love and the grace and all those things of which we've talked about and never truly, truly understood will be living realities. Why? Because now suddenly we see the end of the journey and we're on our way. And thus all of us wait together. We're not alone on this path. For the church for many generations before us have walked the same path and waited patiently. The question is, have you chosen this path of suffering, or have you chosen the broad way of first nation, the first, what do they call us, first world problems? Have we been overtaken by the fact that our VCR not working quite right? You know? Darn, I thought I recorded that. I got problems here, folks. I love, not as much as Paul, but I love
and games and those kinds of things. I do. And I find that to consume my time very easily, take time away from other things. But once in a while you get a break from all of that, and so, you know, you keep it on kind of an even keel. I'm not a good one. Okay. Well, we chosen the idea of traveling, if you want, not so comfortably, but traveling in the sense as brothers and sisters on that narrow road of Christ in those things of which we should be truly concerned about. As Christians, as brothers and sisters in Jesus, are we truly, truly concerned in our great society of the fact that there are lost and dying who don't know Jesus Christ? Are we truly, truly concerned about our families and family members who don't know Jesus Christ? We pray for them. We care for them. But do we weep for them? This is the picture of which I have of John the Revelator, and history tells us, whether it's true or not, I don't know, that he spent so much time in prayer that his knees looked like camel knees, and they used to call them old camel knees, because he spent so much time in prayer. But I can see him weeping for the church while he is exiled to this island. Do we weep for our brothers and sisters? I understand grace. I love grace. I preach grace. I believe in all of those things, but there's also this part of our Christianity in Jesus Christ of which I feel is missing sometimes. The care and nurture and love and the grace of which we have received, do we pass on? John has been banned, as I said, to an extremely hard place, lonely and hard. But John spends his time seeking God. And in this environment, the glorious Christ appears to him. And once more, the revelations of Jesus Christ are showered down. You ever think about this in the sense of a pattern being in the Bible? Okay? So, Joseph in prison. I don't think that was good times. The showers of God fell upon him. We get Moses in the wilderness for 40 years. Somebody who was raised in the very throne room of the Pharaoh, suddenly thrust onto the backside of nowhere for 40 years before God speaks to him. But the revelations follow. David in his constant tribulation. Though David was a man after God's own heart, David's life was not an easy life. He was always at war, whether even with his own family or the nations around and above, or whatever the case may be. But yet the revelations of God shone through David as you read the Psalms and the mighty verses of which he puts forward. Peter in jail, Paul whipped and shipwrecked, and yet the revelations flowed through them. I wonder sometimes, and I'm not going to say that we're going to get great and mighty revelations of which are going to be scripture, but each and every one of us should have revelations in our life delivered to us in our own personal lives of who God is and what he's doing in our lives. But are we receiving them? I don't think so. Not to the degree of which we could be, because we got it so easy and simple that we don't bother looking. I want you to understand, I'm not preaching this message to condemn you, because I've already been convicted myself. Okay? I want you to see where in the Church of North America, not even so much in our personal life, but the church in North America has failed. And I worry about it. All of us should be receiving revelation and knowledge of God who sits upon the throne.
In that still small moment, we should hear that still small voice of God calling you child and telling you that he loves you and asking you to pray for certain things or to do something or maybe to do nothing but to sit and bask in the glory of God.
I have trouble hearing God's voice over the melodious tone of my iPad, in all honesty. So what did John see? Verse 10 of Revelation chapter 1. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. This is the first day of the week, the Lord's Day. This is a Sunday of which he is in the Spirit. It is not the day of the Lord. It is the Lord's Day. That's two different things. And he's in prayer, and he hears a voice. The power of God. In a while, we are worship that we're truly able to. As we spend time in prayer and worship, that's when we're going to hear God's voice. We're going to hear intuitively. God speaks to us. Yet today, and we have to learn to understand when it is God. We all miss it. That's missing the mark. But we should still know. It is while we are in worship that we hear God, as I said, and having him in our life. Ephesians chapter 2, if you flip back there, please. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 6. This is by grace through faith. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 to 6. But God, being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loves us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Even though I wear hearing aids, I usually hear somebody who's sitting right beside me. And if we're raised up in Jesus Christ in heavenly places, as the scriptures say that we are, and we are seated beside him in the heavenlies, we should hear him. This is not something in the sweet by and by. This is what's happened to you and I because we accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We become part of the kingdom of God. And I know it's hard for us to understand that we're raised up into Christ, but yeah, the way that you have to understand this is difficult, but at the same time it's easy. In God there is no time as we understand it, past, present, and future. What there is there's today. The future and the past are all one to God. He sees it all. So he sees the day of which we were born. He saw before we were born. He sees our end. He sees all of those things. And for him, that's not separated in past, present, and future. It is in the present. And the present only. That's what God is. God is the God of today. Not yesterday or tomorrow. Today. So, that being the way, when Jesus Christ was crucified and God said we were in him, he sees us still being in him today. We are raised up in Christ today with God. It's a fact. It's not a theology. It's a fact. I am in Christ. Christ is in me. Well, if that's really true, then we should be hearing personal revelations at least. I'm not saying we're all going to have a great grandiose word for the whole church. I don't believe that. I believe there are people who are called for that. I believe we still have the prophets today. We have the apostles. We have healing ministries. I believe in all of those ministries. But I also believe that each and every one of us in our private walk with Jesus Christ should be in communion with Jesus Christ. We should hear him. I don't think we're going to hear it in the sense of a loud voice, as John heard it. I think we're going to hear it as that still, small voice that first tells us to be calm and then speaks unto us. John freely communicates with the Lord at this time and receives new revelation. And as I said, we can commune freely and receive new revelation concerning our walk with Jesus Christ. Here John enters the world of the Spirit. He will see God's future glory, but first Jesus draws his attention to the current conditions of the church. We are not shown anything in Revelations until we understand the current condition of the church. Verse 11 of Revelation chapter 1, Jesus tells him to write down what he sees and sends it to the seven churches. But why only write to seven? The reason for that is because seven is the number which signifies perfection. There were other churches, we have them written in the books of Acts, that were in Asia at that time, but God chose these seven, and seven represents perfection. He writes to each and every one of them. They represent all of the churches through all of the ages. Now, I don't want you to, there is a teaching out there, and I'm not going to agree or disagree with it, that there are what's so-called church ages of where this represented this time period, and this church represented this time period. I say, okay, fine, that's beyond me. But I do understand this, that I've seen every one of these churches in today's society in one fashion or another. I think what it is a warning to the churches of this is the way you can become. And if you want to do better, these are the things of which you do. So those churches represent all the churches of which we still have today. They're real churches, and the Holy Spirit is about to speak to them in verses 11, or verse 12 to 13a. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking to me, and on turning, I saw seven golden lampstands, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash on his chest. We're not going to get that part today, but that's what we're going to be looking at next week. The seven golden lampstands, I want you to understand that it's not a single lampstand with seven different candles on it. It is seven individual lampstands with one candle. Because it's seven distinct personalities. Every church being autonomous before God. And so he speaks to each lampstand individually because each one individually represents a church. Now, I'm not saying that they're not joined together by the Holy Spirit. They are. What I'm saying, though, is that each one has one candle. One light. And it would be nice to look into heaven because I believe that still, every church still has its own light. And when we find that light and start sharing that light of which Jesus Christ has called us to share, each and every one of us will fill a little niche in Jesus and in the Holy Spirit, and the church will grow. What is our purpose for being here? Some churches have one ministry, another church has another. People say, well, there's so many different denominations and all the rest of it. Why does that have to be? I believe the reason why it has to be is because each and every one of us has been given a specific job. We can't all do the same job. So, the job of this church, what is it, and how do we fulfill it? The job of the next church, same thing. Each of us has our candles, and each of us have our conditions. Each church, as I said, is autonomous. They're responsible for themselves. They have elders within the church who give leadership to the church. There was no denominations at that time. And
by reading chapters 2 and 3, you'll see the conditions of each and every one of them at that time. We are not going to be looking at the conditions of the church. We are going to be looking at who Jesus Christ is as he lays down the conditions of the church. So that we understand that the book of Revelations is first and foremost about our Lord and Savior and not the end. We're going to be looking at Jesus' works, the environment around and about him at this time, at the candlesticks and those kinds of things, the responsibilities and those things of which he lays before John. And my prayer is that when we're all done this, that we will understand the book of Revelations better, because we'll understand that we overcome in Jesus Christ. That we don't live in some kind of fear, or there, whether I'm not taken, or any of the rest of it. If we believe in Jesus Christ, we are in the church, we overcome, and Jesus Christ is going to show us that and why it is, and his priesthood amongst these stars and these candles. Okay? So that's the intro. We will get into the a little more deeply next week. Heavenly Father, I thank you, and I worship you, and I thank you, Father God, for the very fact that indeed you call each and every one of us as individuals, and yet at the same time you knit each and every one of us together into that living temple of which you're building. And I thank you, precious Jesus, for each and every one who's here this morning, and I pray that this week, Father God, in some way, in some special way, you will talk to each and every one of them, and they will recognize your voice, and draw closer unto you because of the love and the affection of which you speak for each and every one of us. And I thank you, Father God, for this.
We hope that you have enjoyed listening to this message as much as we have in bringing it to you. We sincerely hope that God is blessing you in your quest for a deeper relationship with him. We encourage you to share this message with your family and friends. Hi, my name is Steve, and I'm one of the elders here at Riverview Christian Church. If you're not currently attending a church right now and live in the Calgary area, we would love to see you. Our address is 1911 76th Avenue Southeast. If you would like to support our ministry, we can accept email transfers. Our email address is hope.graceforyou@gmail.com. That's hope.grace4you@gmail.com. Support can also be mailed to us. Again, our address is 1911 76th Avenue Southeast, Calgary, Alberta. Our postal code is T2G0C3. A tax receipt can be provided for any support over $20. Please ensure that we have your mailing address so that we can make sure that those receipts get to you. Thanks again, and until next time, take care and God bless.